forgotten that that's what my painting is about. But it's good. Makes sense. So I was thinking about how to talk about my paintings, and I thought a good way of talking about them would be to cover a number of works over the span of several years as a way of seeing a kind of evolution between them, as well as talking about some of the elements that make up each individual painting. But in looking over my work, I've been thinking about the connections that I think I made unconsciously or consciously as I worked through different ideas. So I thought I'd start with this painting, which I made a little over 7 years ago, which was, it's a large painting, it's about 6 feet tall, but this was the first painting that I based on a photograph. I'd worked mainly from landscape and still life up to that time, and then I wanted to start using other sources of inspiration. So I was drawn to this photograph I had taken for its peculiarness of the scene. It was a figure, a street performer, all painted white, playing a guitar in front of a white van, which was in front of a white truck, in front of this facade, and then this speckled light, which unified the whole composition. So I used that to begin with as a way of working through ideas of flat color and design, as well as using a figure who had some mystery to him. But I very quickly, despite inventing within the limitation of this snapshot that I'd taken, I got antsy with the use of one photograph as a way of making a painting. So I started using more than one source of imagery, including my own imagination and sense of what a painting needs as I start working on it. So I used a couple of different images, a photograph of a post office, an image from a newspaper, and then an invented figure and a bench, and constructed this composition using color and shape as a way of organizing it. And thinking about light and landscape, as well as structures that cast shadows that can create ways of obscuring or revealing imagery. And I'd used an overpass and bridges as a source for a long time. I was working from life, and I liked this, the way that that could create a framework for whatever was going on underneath or around. This is a large painting, about 8 feet wide, and this was, again, using a bridge, but this was an invented bridge. I didn't work from life, and I started becoming more interested in the shapes of light and the way that color was responding in different areas of the painting. And I started using animals and a circus theme as a way of grounding the story and making the painting fun for myself, but retaining the abstract and formal relationships of the different elements of the painting. In this case, the arch of the bridge echoing the arch of the elephant was actually a happy accident, because I had the elephant going into the bridge, and then he was coming out of the bridge, and he was way to the left, and he was too small, and suddenly he became this size, and I thought, well, that was obvious. If I'd been a Renaissance painter, I would have figured that one out to begin with, but I hadn't. So it was nice that that happened. And thereafter, I think I was, my attention was drawn to the relationship of measurement and structure as a way of making sense of a composition.
How long ago was this work that we're seeing now?
Right now, that I'm showing on the screen?
Yeah.
So this was about 5 years ago.
I was just wondering about the chronology.
Yes, so those, yeah, those were 7, 6, now
sure.
This is 5. I'm going a little bit faster at the beginning. So I still used animals and imaginary scenes, but also familiar thoughts from my own experience. But interested in some kind of strangeness in the story, and having the horse's head come off and then re-enter the picture, but playing at the same time with the broad shapes of color and the resonance between the arms of the figure and then the legs. Of the horse itself. I was also using a very dark palette, which is hard to see in slides, so I think that added to this mystical effect. But I started also using paintings from the past as reference, and that figure in particular came from this figure in a Courbet painting that I'd seen around that time. And I just thought she was so strange. Her whole body was very doll-like and stiff, but very intriguing at the same time. So I just used that basic figure, although I did change proportions because I needed, this figure's arms needed to be longer because I needed to echo the horse's legs a little bit more accurately. So I use whatever I can, but then I usually change it for my own needs. Again, another circus-inspired painting. I'm not sure why circus specifically. Picasso went through his circus period, so maybe that was in the back of my mind, but I'm not sure what it was. I think I like the idea of using animals as stand-ins for maybe human beings, but also they offer various different shapes to play with, so I enjoyed that. And then I started thinking about stage-like scene with shallow space and concentrating all of the figures into one scene, and not paying so much attention to the realistic qualities of the figures. The central woman with her leg going over the zebra head, for instance, just turns into a line or a shape of purple, so you can't see the figure remaining visible. And the side of the face of the figure looks like the side of the face of the zebra, as well as the body of the figure. So those elements that start to create the connection, these connections, just formal connections, but then they become more psychological also, I think, more interesting to me. And I've been introduced to, or not introduced, but I thought of Piero della Francesca a lot in his way of using different scales and measurement as a way of connecting disparate parts of the composition that just created a lot of interesting visual effects. So I then became more cinematic in my use of different elements, using animals and cars and props. That clearly are still odd, but in a more literal oddness, I think. I liked the gazelle. I just thought it was a beautiful animal. The shapes were interesting. Putting these animals in the scenes with humans created a somewhat dreamlike, but possibly not dream situation. And I was drawing a lot from figures, figure models. And still using some darks, but I did start to lighten my palette as time went by. And I actually, at the time when I started brightening up my palette, because I was reading a book about color, which was very interesting, and it actually was particularly pertinent when I worked on this painting. But my cousin, who was 10 at the time, said that he admired my work, but he preferred my chiaroscuro phase. So but I never really went back to my chiaroscuro phase, even so. But this painting, I used vermilion and ultramarine, which I've been reading about being used in early Renaissance paintings, and I just, luminosity that I could see, I loved. So I still using them in flat ways, but trying to make the overall composition coherent. And in this case, this painting is large, but I was also trying to fill it with elements from my past painting. So you can see at the top, this painting is being lowered down into the stage-like set, and the horses and the gazelle and the car, and they're being placed into this medieval structure. I know I'm talking very formally, but this is how I think about them. But of course, there's plenty of there's more going on, but that's I prefer that for everyone else to interpret rather than me. So this was another painting that where I was inspired by another Renaissance painter called Carpaccio, and I was just looking through a book, and he has a lot of scenes where all of the figures are in a shallow stage area, and then you see much farther in the distance other activity going on. But I've always been drawn to the closeness of the activity and how that offers a play of flatness and pattern that I'm interested in using. And here all of the figures are headless, so the main sources of personality, I suppose, are the gazelles looking at each other, or maybe one of them is looking at the screen. But the painting I've used was just this, the gate coming out of this painting. Just that element on the bottom center I liked. I liked the shadows, and I liked the options with the vertical and horizontal patterns. So then, this was about 4 years ago, 5 years ago, and I started a series based on a particular perspective, because I wanted to enter into the painting more directly, not have a screen-like effect or a feeling that something was blocking my entrance. So I started a series based on looking under a table, which was also inspired by babysitting and being under tables a lot, which I hadn't had to do since I was little myself. And I remember walking by furniture store, an antique furniture store, and the furniture was all up on a level, and I was with a three-year-old friend of mine at the time, and we looked up and we saw this table, and it occurred to me that I spent a lot of time with her looking up when we were on the ground, and it was very, very familiar to me for, in a way that I didn't, that was striking at the time, but I, particularly with the animal legs as representative of certain kinds of furniture that I remembered from my childhood. And it also gave me, again, some kind of vertical and horizontal structure to work with as a way of moving into the space and allowing moments of flatness and depth. So there are a number of paintings where I use that perspective and thinking about the color as another element, another subject. This painting is called Pause, P-A-U-S-E, but always reference to other calls. And I also liked how the shadow starts to become its own kind of animal also. So I enjoy being surprised or interested in what starts to happen as I'm painting. Even if I have a basic compositional idea in mind, almost every painting I make does evolve in its own way, and things come up that I wouldn't expect, which is what I hope for. This is another painting. This is Party Dog. So I had this theme, which was interesting because I had never thought in those terms before, but it really lent itself to inventing more because I had some kind of compositional or maybe subjective kind of limitation that made me think about something has to be happening above, below. And so, anyway, what else? So this painting was, again, based on that idea, but then starting to maybe remove the table or the horizontal of the table as a structural component, bringing in some more mystical or magical strangeness, as in the zebra. And if anyone hasn't seen George Stubbs's painting of a zebra at the Yale Museum of British Art, I highly recommend it. It's a very strange, beautiful painting. And it has a zebra in the forest where zebras do not live, but it's really quite beautiful. So I was thinking about that painting. Then I thought, well, the table doesn't have to be straight across. I can start cutting into the composition and being more free with the way that I move the shapes and the subjects around. And I'd seen a lecture by a photographer whom I really admire named Laura Latinsky. And I saw this picture. She does beautiful photographs of very spare rooms with tables with a few objects on them. Or at least this series was about that. And this particular painting just seemed to, it very simply made me decide to start cutting into the composition in a different way and using a curve as a way of moving the space, moving your eye around the space, and also creating flatness and corners where they hadn't been before. And always using elements of my life or memory in some way, even if bizarre. This was a painting of an interior, this was about 4 years ago, of an airplane. I did a couple of these, and I think this was one of my more photographic paintings because there are areas of focus and areas of blurred focus that led your eye, or leads your eye around the composition in a way that makes you move through the space differently than I am thinking about before. This is another international flight two. The other one was international flight one. This painting is called Teapot. It's based on a poem by Thomas Hardy called At Tea. And I don't know what to say about it. It still has a table, so that was familiar to me. But I started pushing space differently, using a face to actually cut into the composition. And the red that's side of someone's face, which also echoes a leg form, but also the hair in that red recalls red curtains throughout art history, and that always excites me somehow, to have some connection, even without doing it on purpose. And I rarely do it on purpose, but here's an example, not one of my paintings, unfortunately, but Velázquez, Venus and Cupid. The red curtain is really just attention to as a way of both revealing and concealing, and I think those two ways of thinking about making an image or a composition also interest me. I stopped cropping figures so much. I thought of gesture and posture as another way of creating relationships and interlocking of shapes and psychological spaces. And pattern, stripes, dots. Simple ways of moving color around or flattening spaces. Please fill out these forms. I applied to many jobs, grants, residencies, exhibitions, as one does, and I noticed a lot of other people doing the same thing, and this was very relevant to my life at this time. Of course, these are pieces of paper, but people still use paper sometimes, so and most people would be on their laptops. This painting, which is in this room, I went back to cropping, but focusing more on the heads and the gesture or glance or expression of the different postures. The little doll at the bottom, I think I only thought of this just today, but I think that that has to do with that Courbet painting that I worked on before. So the space is flat, but there's a way of moving into the structure, both coloristically and through the connection of the limbs, even if they're not touching. This is called Fabric Softener. This is about 3 years ago. 2 years ago. 2 years ago. And I, near my studio, there are a number of laundromats, and I started painting a laundromat without knowing why. And then I realized on a walk one day that I was constantly looking into these spaces and noticing these circles at different distances from me, and then the patterns of the fabric, and I just thought it would be interesting to make a painting about that. And the figure in back is taken from a Balthus painting, which was also taken, I think, from a Michelangelo slave sculpture also. So three degrees of separation. Anyway, so this painting is also in this room. Again, thinking about the expressiveness of gesture and poses, and using more contour lines as a way to paint, as opposed to the just color blocks, although most of the atmosphere is built up in those blues and greens as a contrast to the linearity of the yellow and orange figures. That was called Waiting for the PowerPoint. This is slide lecture. So I think sometimes there are more realistic elements, sometimes less, depending on how much of the space I want to flatten. There still is a bust of Elvis in a record store that's been there all my life in Cambridge. And I just liked it and I wanted to include him in a painting. And I also thought the way that a reflection against glass could create more clarity and also saturated colors in the way that the muted colors of the light against the glass versus the saturation next to it, as well as the confusion as to whether that is a reflection or another figure. This is in honor of art history. It's someone looking at a book with a detail of by Lorenzetti on the cover. And one of the feet is taken from Mantegna's Dead Christ, but I don't know which one. This painting is called Control Top. I don't know where it began, but I think after my chiaroscuro phase, but I think that I think humor became more apparent, not on purpose, but it is more familiar to me as a way of thinking about narratives. So usually there's some potentially silliness even within serious expressions. This one is behind the screen membership. And while still retaining this interest in the lines and the patterning as a way to move through the space, there's also the figures that echo each other, but one is in profile and one is moving into the space more obliquely. And I like that dynamic of having ways of different and at times contradictory ways of moving into the space that add to the oddness. This is called Neither Here Nor There.
Was that last one oil or was it acrylic?
Oil. This one is oil. This one is acrylic. I used watered down layers of acrylic for parts, as you can see, and then focused in on the center area. I had always loved Degas' paintings because of his, well, for many, many reasons, but one of them being the way that he could articulate certain details and specific features of a figure, and then express much more abstractly and coloristically or with pattern the rest of the abstract of the composition in a way that still cohered very nicely. So I like having areas of more specificity, areas of broader, more generalized shapes of color, and a story that somehow makes some sense as you look at it. This is a figure I made when I was working in a very small, cramped space. And I started working just to work, just to make something. I just started putting colors and shapes down. And this figure started to emerge, and I realized it was emerging for a reason, because I was working at a coffee table with about 2 feet of space. And so the whole structure seemed to make a lot of sense as I was working on it. And it had also, I do think about the older Egyptian and ancient Greek reliefs and sculptures and this eternal sense of form. Somehow, this makes me think about this painting. It's on that wall right here. Again, forcing a composition out of a narrow space, I think, because this painting had been horizontal and a completely different painting for a long time, but I found a need to start pushing figures inward. This is a collage. I often work making small paintings, drawing into them, cutting them up, collaging them together until something works for whatever reason. This is a small collage, about 9 by 10 inches, which then I worked from to make a larger painting. But like with the first photograph of the guitarist, I can never copy something. I just rebel against myself, and so it ends up being something very different, even if they're similar compositional elements. And in any case, when you go up in scale, things have to change. This is 9 by 9 inches, another collage, and then I made a slightly larger painting, about 20 inches high. This is acrylic, and then a larger one from there, which is about 46 inches high. This is another small painting I did. Having spent some time in a park that had a lot of columns, the use of columns as a way to obscure and then reveal different parts. Since I had always liked the way that cropping or using parts of figures or subject matter could help with the compositional ideas. That one then led to this painting, which is in this show also. Although in this case, it's not the columns that obscure, but the figures that cover each other or create different lines. This was a small 9 by 9 inch painting in gouache that led to the other one behind the screen, this one. And this is an example where, in going up in scale, I realized I needed another figure just for the space. It just didn't make sense otherwise. The color is completely different, and I think it doesn't really have much to do with the other one except for the two figures on the left. But I think there's a lot about the atmosphere that's very different. And I think that foot I stole from a Picasso painting. I'm not sure who else. And then recently I've just been working on things not having to be clearly related to a representational space of any kind. or at least not realistically so. This was done looking out a window onto a porch, and I'd made a number of little paintings, and I just didn't like any of them. I wanted to reconstruct them. And so it's really playing with form and color and pattern, and then creating some space that seems to resonate somehow. And then from this, which is about 10 inches high, I think, that became this painting. There's much less of a relationship, I think, between these two. But they're, in my mind, connected. But when I went up in scale, I think I wanted the figure to make more sense, feel more real, even while disappearing into the background. This was another collage. The head, I didn't even know this was a figure for a long time, and then I suddenly saw a face, and the face was made out of little paintings I'd done of purple tacos I'd seen in the magazine. And then, so you can see the side of the face is actually a taco, but anyway, this became this painting. So once I made it into a painting, I could edit and use the material of the paint itself in a different way. I like the way that collage can be reinvented in a painting, but I do also really like to use paint for its own qualities. And this is where I end. I wanted to keep a painting that was not realistic because I wanted it to be more about the play of what I've been saying, these shapes. In this case, I liked the points of the leaves also. The points and the colors, the shadows of the pink petals. And I also wanted to put them in more of a human-like world. So I think of them as figures, actually. But I spent a lot of time with that painting on color. That was what I spent most of my time, because I was using very flat shapes, and that's acrylic. Some areas that have more transparency to them. Yes?
It seems like why your decision process as you're painting is very formal. It's composition, colors, and I'm just wondering if that's also the case at the inception of your idea, at the very beginning.
No.
Do you start?
No, I start with many things. I start with something someone said, or something I saw on the street, or a word, or an atmosphere. It's usually, there's the formal stuff is just the way that I make sense of the original idea, but it doesn't start with form.
Procedurally, do you work these out in some other way first on paper? Do you draw it on the canvas? Do you just hit the canvas and it comes out? Or?
Well, some of them, like some of the smaller drawings that were collages over there, mm-hmm. I showed as the first part of the development of the work, and then I went to upscale. Mm-hmm. I do like working on different scales. I like to work on a small scale, quickly figuring things out, generating ideas, and then moving up in scale where it's for different things to end up, like color and layering and space.
So on these larger ones, you've usually done some small projects, some good.
Yes. Yes. Almost always. But not always. No, I'm just thinking that they all come about. I never have a system because I don't know how to have a system. I don't even want a system. But I do, a lot of them start out as very different paintings. So sometimes I will have smaller pieces that I've worked on that I then impose on a different composition, and then I see
But the collages are not like preparatory drawings or anything.
No, I don't think of them.
It's something that you take off from when you're doing a painting. Did you say this vertical painting started as a horizontal?
Yes. It was just horrible. I wanted to make a painting just of heads. And not, I mean, not gruesome and gruesome. So I had the idea started with a bunch of heads, and that way, and it didn't work.
The vertical and horizontal compositional fix. It's, I mean, the grid, your paintings are so apparently have such high regard for the grid, or the vertical horizontal axis.
Yeah. I never use a grid or measure outright, but I do think.
Yeah, but that presence of the horizontal.
When you do progress through your paintings from the small to the large, or for different shapes into different forms, is that something that you use, the progression in time, does that happen, does it usually happen to you very soon, or is it something that you might study for, say, a year or two before
going
you move onward?
Going from smaller to large.
Or just from a form, is it something that you're working on through the painting, or will you do
yes.
the painting first and then receive inspiration to move on to something else?
It's both. It's everything. I can work small and then big, or work big and then work small from the big one, and then make a few different things. Mm-hmm. Because working on paper just feels somehow less precious. It feels as though I can make a mistake and rip it up and it's fine. Mm-hmm. With a canvas, it doesn't quite feel that way. Although I try to make it feel that way. So to be able to move fluidly through different using different materials at different scales makes the whole development of the work easier. But I wouldn't say that it, I don't know, everything takes the time it takes, but there's I don't know how long. It all takes a long time. And some things are very quick, but it's rare, because I usually like to work on many paintings at the same time and use different elements from other work.
Is that the membership? It's a health club?
Membership.
What is it?
It is. It's treadmills going back in space.
Oh, well, that's a treadmill.
Yes. The viewer enters onto a treadmill, which is dangerous. I've fallen off that.
Treadmills.
Yes. Yes.
As you were showing slides, I kept thinking, oh, she's looked at Tolstoy's, oh, she's looked at Renaissance painting. And I realized, well, hell, Walters is a Renaissance
yes.
painter. There you go.
It's cheating. It's
but there is that. Subtle Art Deco French palette. I've been translating the Bulges love letters for a while.
Oh.
He talks about what he dares to steal and what he prefers to disguise. But he knows, he says.
Yes. I think I've exposed too much in the more mysterious.
For the sake of the name of this being called Reading Into Things, on a few of the earlier slides, as Wade had pointed out, the one that looked like a deer, the figure that was reaching over the back, I noticed almost a theme in a few of the earlier ones that looks, dare I say, assaultive?
Assaultive?
Yeah, just like with the automobile in the car, there was a male figure.
Yes. No, it's. I see what you're saying. It's not what I was thinking about. But in fact, when I talked about the curve, the table coming to the composition, I think that is more violent than figures. I was thinking that it was a very theatrical setup. Not that it doesn't imply, it can imply other things, but that word would have come to mind. But that's my.
Stop question that I like hearing artists talk about, you know, why they do anything at all. Can you talk about why you make art?
Because I always liked it, and I didn't know that I didn't really think I could do it. And then I realized I really can't do it. I really don't want to do anything else, so I think I'm going to try to do this. That was my train of thought, simply. It interests me in a way that keeps me curious endlessly. So that's good enough for me.
That's good. Did you start painting before, during, or after you were an art history student?
Way before.
Way before.
I was painting while I was an art history student.
Yeah, you have a master's in art history.
In art history, yes. I always drew and painted when I was little, and then up until now. It's just a question of how much time I could devote to it. So.
Sarah, you use color to separate out certain forms, isolate things, so you get those movement through the painting. Colors are attached to certain things. When you build that palette, you're picking those colors that kind of pushed. Al Sam is associated with maybe the drawing, the composition, but the color seems to be pushed.
Towards, you mean work with?
The energy of the color.
Yeah.
It really gets back. But you isolate the color.
Yes.
In sections.
Yes. Areas of more saturation than that's natural.
How do you, when you're picking your palette out, do you have the color?
I usually start with a color that I just choose, I think usually arbitrarily, and then I have to respond to that with another color, and then I have to keep going until it doesn't bother me. And that's as clear as I've ever been able to understand it. I don't start out with a ready to color.
Sarah, we are so grateful that art was what you chose to do. And we are looking forward to seeing much more in the future. Thank you so much. Thank you for a wonderful exhibition and a wonderful talk.